In this video, you will find that a crane is being used to pick up objects. Now, you will notice that there is something different about this crane. A normal conventional crane has a hook, but this crane does not have a hook. But how do you think that it is being able to pick up these scraps and different objects? If you notice closely, you will find that the moment the crane goes near the object gets attracted to the crane. And then when the crane has reached a spot where it needs to drop these objects, it simply drops them. Now, this looks like some sort of a magnet, doesn't it? But it's a magnet whose magnetic properties can be switched on and off according to one's convenience. So, what exactly do you think it is? A magnet whose properties can be switched on and off according to our needs? Let us find out more about this. You can perform a very simple experiment at home. The experiment involves taking a nail like the one you see in the picture and winding an insulated wire around it. Now make sure both the ends of the wire are connected across a battery, as you can see. Now the moment you connect it across the battery and take it near, let's say, safety pins like the ones you see, you will find that the safety pins get attracted, much like what you will see in this animation. So, the moment the wires are connected across the battery, you will find the pins are attracted by this nail. And the moment the wires are let go, you will find that the nails also fall off. So, what exactly do you think is going on over here? We found that when current is passing through the nail, or when we are connecting the ends of the wire to the battery, it is able to attract the safety pins around it. So we can say that the moment current starts passing, it acquires magnetic properties. But you also saw that the moment the wires were taken off the battery, the safety pins fell off. So what does this mean? This means that this particular nail no longer behaves like a magnet. So we can conclude that when current is not passing through the wires anymore, or when it stops flowing through the nail, then it does not or is no longer able to attract the safety pins around it. So we can say that it loses the magnetic properties. And as is evident, you see that the magnetic properties can be switched on and off according to our convenience as we allow current to flow or cease current to flow through the wire around the nail. So this kind of a magnet is known as an electromagnet. So how can we define an electromagnet? An electromagnet is a temporary magnet whose magnetic properties exist as long as current flows in the coil wound around it. Now there are a few key aspects to remember. The first thing is that electromagnet is a temporary magnet. Or in other words, the magnetic properties of the electromagnet will be present only as long as current is flowing in the coil around it. So in the previous case, we saw that the nail behaved as a magnet only when current flowed in the coil. The moment current stopped flowing, it lost its magnetic properties. So thus, we can say an electromagnet is dependent on its magnetic properties, which in turn depends on the electric current flowing through the coil. Now in this animation, notice what happens. Over here we have a given number of turns in the coil, and when we connect it to the battery, the nails close to it are attracted. Now notice what happens when we increase the number of turns in the coil. Under such a situation, when we connect both the ends to the battery, all the nails, all the safety pins that were scattered around get attracted to the nail. So what is the basic difference we find? We find that when the number of turns are less, less pins are attracted. However, if we increase the number of turns in this particular nail, we find that the magnetic properties are enhanced and it is able to attract all the pins, even the ones that are kept far from one another. So we can say that the magnetic properties depend on the number of turns. The magnetic force of attraction will be greater if the number of turns are greater, and it will be lesser if the number of turns are less. So now let us study about the various kinds of electromagnets that are there. Now, commonly, there are two types of electromagnets. The first type is known as the I-shaped electromagnet, the one that I have been talking about so far. The I-shaped electromagnet commonly consists of a nail, like the one you see in the picture, and has an insulated wire wound around. Both ends of the wire are connected to a battery through a switch. This switch can be switched on and off in order to control the magnetic properties of this I-shaped electromagnet. So as you can see, this coil is made from insulated wire. The moment the switch is closed, the battery supplies current to the coil and it gets magnetized. Now, as you can see, these wires are wound around in the form of loops. Now, we have studied what happens to current when it flows in a loop and what polarity is developed. So this, as you can see, is made up of many such loops, which represents a solenoid. So now let us see how we can find out the polarity developed at either end of the nail. If you view the nail from the bottom end, you will find that current is leaving the bottom end in a clockwise direction through the wire. We have studied that when clockwise direction current is flowing, it represents the south pole. So we can say that the southern polarity or south pole is created at the bottom end of the nail. In a similar manner, let us consider the top end of the nail. At the top end, if you see it from this angle, you will find that current is entering in an anti-clockwise direction. Now, we have studied in the case of current-carrying loop that an anti-clockwise flow of current represents north pole. So we can say that northern polarity or north pole is created at this particular end of the nail. So we found that at the bottom end, south pole is created, and at the top end, north pole is created. This polarity can be reversed if we simply reverse the direction of current by inversing the battery. So instead of keeping the battery like this, if I simply invert it, then I will successfully invert the polarity present on this electromagnet as well. So now let us talk about the second type of electromagnet that is commonly in use. This kind of electromagnet is also known as the U-shaped or the horseshoe-shaped electromagnet. Now the horseshoe-shaped electromagnet has many applications, one of which is very, very common. Now in the picture you will find a calling bell that was in use previously. This calling bell employs a horseshoe-shaped or a U-shaped magnet. This U-shaped magnet is an electromagnet. So let us now find out how the U-shaped or the horseshoe-shaped electromagnet behaves in a calling bell. Firstly, we need to discuss about the construction of such an electromagnet. So in this animation, you will find the simple working of a horseshoe-shaped magnet or a U-shaped electromagnet. Over here, you can see that we have considered a U-shaped bar and we have labeled the arms as P and Q. Now over these arms, the wire has been wound. Now you will see that the moment we are closing the switch, the iron plate that is present below the magnet is getting attracted. This is because current is flowing in both arms, P as well as Q, and producing a certain polarity at both P and Q. So now let us study how we can determine what polarity is being developed at which particular arm. Considering the direction of current, as you can see in this animation, you will find that if I look at arm P, the wire that has been wound has been taken from the bottom end of arm P and wound in an anti-clockwise manner. Once the top of arm P is reached, the wire is drawn across and we reach arm Q. At arm Q, the wire is wound in a clockwise manner and it is connected to both ends of the battery. Now you tell me that when current starts flowing, what polarity is developed at arm P? In arm P, the current is flowing in an anti-clockwise manner, so northern polarity or north pole is developed. Similarly, at arm Q, current is leaving in a clockwise manner, so south pole is developed at arm Q. Thus, we can say that when current is flowing through the U-shaped electromagnet, arm P develops north pole and arm Q develops south pole. This also can be reversed if I simply reverse the direction of current flow. So now let us look at the working of a simple calling bell. Now you will notice that when the switch is closed, current starts flowing. In the left hand side, that is the left arm, that is arm P, north pole is developed, and in the right arm, that is arm Q, south pole is developed. Now if you notice closely, you will find that there is a make and break of circuit that is going on. If you look closely, you will find that the moment the switch is closed, this rod that is present below the electromagnet gets attracted because this U-shaped bar behaves like a magnet. Now the moment it gets attracted, it is leaving the pin-shaped contact. When it leaves the pin-shaped contact, the circuit gets broken. So this bar falls back. Again, when it falls back, the circuit is made and current starts flowing in the electromagnet once again. So it is attracted again. Now the moment it gets attracted, it leaves this contact, and what happens is it falls back again because current ceases to flow and the magnet loses its magnetic properties. So this process is repeated over a period of time as long as the switch remains closed. So as you can see, the end of this rod contains a small hammer. This hammer is responsible for striking the gong of the bell repeatedly, and therefore we can hear the rattling sound of the bell when somebody is at our door. Now the wire turns are often wound around a magnetic core, as you saw. In the previous cases, the magnetic core was either a nail or a U-shaped bar. Now this magnetic core is preferably made from materials which are strongly affected by a magnet. Only those materials that are strongly affected by a magnet, for example, iron, are considered for making these cores. Now, what are these substances called? If you recall, those substances that are strongly attracted or affected by a magnet are known as ferromagnetic substances or simply magnetic substances. Iron and nickel are both examples of magnetic substances because these substances are strongly affected by a magnet when placed near them. Now let us see why iron or soft iron is preferably used for making these cores. Now one of the basic properties of magnets which we had earlier studied was that no single pole can exist in isolation. Or in other words, if we go on breaking a magnet into smaller and smaller pieces, we will find that it is impossible to achieve a single north pole or a single south pole, because even the smallest unit will also contain a north pole as well as a south pole. And this is true down to the absolute very molecular level. So let us say we zoom down to the absolute molecular level of the substance. Now, if we zoom down to the molecular level and consider each molecule as a magnet, we will find that each of them will have a north pole and south pole, but under normal circumstances, they are haphazardly distributed. Now, what happens when it is brought near a magnet or rubbed against a magnet? We will find that the same substance gets magnetized. When I say magnetized, I mean that these molecules will arrange themselves in a manner as you can see from this picture. Now over here, if you look closely, you will find that the north pole of one magnet faces the south pole of the next magnet, and so on. Now when I'm saying magnet, I mean the molecules that have arranged themselves in this particular manner. If you consider either end of the substance, however, you will find that at one end, there is an array of north poles, and at the other end, there is an array of south poles. What does this imply? This implies that unlike any central portion in the substance, these north poles and south poles are not coupled with any opposite poles facing them. So this means that this particular end develops north pole and this particular end develops south pole. And under this circumstance, we say that the substance has been magnetized. So this is the reason why soft iron is used to make electromagnets. The reason it is used to make electromagnets is because when current flows around soft iron, the arrangement that I previously showed you is achievable very easily. The magnets or the molecules which behave as magnets inside soft iron align themselves in that particular manner as soon as current starts flowing. However, the moment current stops flowing through the electromagnet, it loses its magnetic properties, because those molecules which had arranged themselves in that particular manner are again randomly arranged because current no longer flows. So soft iron does not have the capability to retain its magnetic properties. However, steel on the other hand can retain the magnetic properties. So once a steel bar is magnetized, it remains a magnet for a good number of years. Or in other words, for a long, long time, steel will remain a magnet, and this is the reason why steel is used to make permanent magnets, whereas soft iron is used to make temporary magnets. Now I have a question for you. You must have often seen that certain kinds of door stoppers are used, where against which if you place the doors get attracted. And again, if you pull the door comes off easily. Now my question to you is that, do you think these door stoppers are made of electromagnets or permanent magnets? The answer is that these door stoppers are made of permanent magnets and not electromagnets. Now you might be wondering, and you might even be puzzled as to how this is the case. Well, the point is that if it were made of electromagnets, it would involve a definite hazard of electricity flowing around this particular structure. It is made of permanent magnets because we have to eliminate that hazard, and also because the construction of an electromagnet in such a small space is not very convenient. Now, the moment I say it is made of permanent magnets, you might be wondering that how this is the case, because the moment we pull the door, it is no longer attracted. That is because these permanent magnets are not very strong. They are only as strong as to keep the door in place when the door is nearby. The moment you pull the door away, these magnets are not strong enough to keep the door pulled back. So these door stoppers are made of permanent magnets that are not very strong. So we have studied about an electromagnet that is also a temporary magnet, and we have also studied about permanent magnets. Now let us take a look at the differences in between electromagnets and permanent magnets. The first point of difference is that in a permanent magnet, the strength of the magnetic field is constant. However, in an electromagnet, the strength of the magnetic field can be varied. How? If we increase the current flowing in the coil, or if we increase the number of turns in the coil. The second point of difference is that permanent magnets cannot be easily demagnetized. Or in other words, their magnetic properties will exist for a very good period of time, and that period of time can be several years at a stretch. However, electromagnets can be easily demagnetized. How? By simply switching off the current that passes through it. So the properties of electromagnet can be switched on and off if we simply switch on and off the current. Lastly, the polarity of a permanent magnet cannot be reversed. However, the polarity of an electromagnet can be reversed. In a very simple manner, if we simply reverse the direction of current that is flowing through the given electromagnet that we have considered. So taking a quick recap, we studied about two basic things. The first thing we studied about is an electromagnet, which is a temporary magnet which acquires magnetic properties once electric current flows through it in a coil wound around it. We also saw that the strength of the electromagnet is dependent on the number of turns as well as on the current flowing through the coil. Lastly, we also saw that the substances used for constructing an electromagnet are substances like soft iron or nickel. In other words, magnetic substances which can easily achieve the molecular structure or the molecular arrangement as I showed you previously. And over here, we found out about the various differences in between permanent magnets and electromagnets.